You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi everyone, welcome to the Sociology of Work. My name is Sergio Soto and this is our fourth broadcast, and today's topic will be the bureaucracy. Now, before we go into what the bureaucracy is and why it's so important to not only work but our everyday lives, let's talk about a little bit about this course. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on the on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This fall, we will broadcast four classes: Communication 365, Introduction to Public Relations, on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. Labor 412, Labor Law, on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. Sociology 315, this course, Sociology of Work, on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. and Science, Math, and Technology 312, Natural Disasters, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. So if you've completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then we'll start all over again. So, you know, you can do all this from home, I guess. So if you'd like more information about this program, the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudiestv or call 1-866-278-6789. Right? Great program. This class is part of it. But again, you don't have to, you know, require the grade to participate and view this program. Again, we're coming to you live this week, not like last week, but live today. And anyone in our community watching is welcome to call, text, and share their insight. Now, again, one of the brilliant things about, you know, being able to broadcast this course live to the greater Los Angeles area and all over the world, really, is that everyone can share their perspectives on work. Now, work is something that we all do. Sometimes it's paid. Sometimes it's what we do to kind of maintain our, you know, not only life, but standard of living. And today, you know, we're going to discuss the bureaucracy. Now, before we start our, you know, step-by-step breakdown of the history, the different parts of the bureaucracy, one thing to kind of think about is, you know, why is it so important? Important enough to cover it in just one lecture, right? The easy thing to say is that a bureaucracy is a hierarchical organization, but it's much more complex than that, right? There's a history to it. If you really think about it, it's the way by de facto we organize our organizations, the way we work, our government. And it's not only, you know, public entities, but private entities that kind of follow this line of thinking, this, you know, basis of rationale or rationality, right? You know, this line, you know. One thing I like to ask or kind of suggest is for everyone to kind of think about, if you were tasked with creating a group or organizing a group or a place of work, you know, how would you organize it? Most of us would choose something that's very bureaucratic. Like, of course, there'll be a hierarchy, right? We'll have a leader, and, you know, most of it will be organized or ideally organized around efficiency, a division of labor. And this idea, this bureaucracy, is something that's been copied everywhere, right? You know, if you're taking this course, you've had to deal with the bureaucracy. there's a division of labor here, right? I teach the course, you know, but I'm not the person who helps you with your financial aid or delivers your transcripts when you finish, right? All of those are specialized jobs within this bureaucracy, right? We also want to think about kind of the negative context the bureaucracy, and you know, is kind of categorized as in our society, right? Usually when folks talk about, you know, especially in an election year, people will criticize the government for being too big or too bureaucratic. However, that didn't happen overnight. As a matter of fact, I would suggest that people love the bureaucracy, or at least love to hate it, but love, you know, participating, you know, in it. We, you know, our expectation is that whenever we see a large organization is that it's bureaucratic. For example, if you've ever had a, you know, problem at a store or someplace that offers a service and you're dissatisfied, you know, usually the first question you, your first demand might be, you know, who do I speak to remedy this? Or let me speak to your manager, right? That assumption that we all make, you know, in that situation assumes that there's a bureaucracy, you know, at work, right? There's a, you know, chain of command. So we'll explore that as we go through today. So first, let's talk about the rise of the bureaucracy as an organization. You know, it has a long history. We covered a little bit about it, you know, a few weeks ago and last week. It stems back to the pre-industrial empires like the Roman and Chinese, or the dynasties in China, and they served an essential function, right? One way to think about it as that is that as the state grew, as society became more and more complex, the demands of society, or you know, the group of people that were, you know, under this same political authority, became more taxing for the elite, so there had to be some organization, right? A lot of it, again, you know, I mentioned taxes a lot, you know, some of it's linked with taxes, right? You know, the military, right? If you're going to have an organized fighting group or a war-making machine, there has to be some organization to it, some authority within it, right? So you start to see the bureaucracy first emerge, right? So primarily it first emerged in the military as, you know, empires needed to be defended, and, you know, this was costly. So again, the money had to come from somewhere, so you see taxation. So there's a correlation between the invention of war and the maintenance of armies for large empires and taxation, right? So, you know, someone had to count the beans and push the paper, so you start to see a bureaucracy. Bureaucracies also function today and as they did, you know, centuries ago to preserve order, right? And we'll look at different types of bureaucracies. And some government bureaucracies were, you know, involved in productive activities, right? So what we experience today is very different, very different in some ways, but not so different in other ways, you know, from the bureaucracies of old. Now, the first thing we're going to kind of look at is a five-minute video with former Senator George Mitchell on Congress and the bureaucracy. Now, the reason I show you all this is to kind of start framing how the bureaucracy works. Like, for the most part, most of us are, again, familiar with it when we ask for services from the government, right? A bureaucracy that we all, for the most part, have dealt with, or, you know, a bureaucracy that has kind of like a spoiled identity, if you will, some place that has a bad name is something like the DMV, right? Long lines, forms are very important, you know, policy is followed, and, you know, everyone for the most part in society can say, oh, I hate the DMV, and that's a shared experience, right? However, in the defense of something like the DMV, right, you know, somewhere in California, you have to regulate and provide services for millions of drivers in the state. So although you wait 2 hours, right, it's somewhat efficient, right? Well, I mean, that's kind of one of the things we're going to argue today, right? Is it really efficient, or is it, you know, is the rationality behind it really irrational? So anyway, with governance, it's no different, right? We talk about, or politicians talk about, reducing the red tape or cutting through red tape, you know, the red tape of bureaucracy. But again, you know, the government keeps growing, right? You know, as services become more complex, the bureaucracy starts creating new jobs and new, you know, outsourcing these needs to new organizations. So, you know, what we get from our government often is constructed by how, I mean, how we get things from our government is kind of dictated by the construction of the bureaucracy at work, right? So anyway, we'll take a short look, we'll take a look at the short video with former Senator George Mitchell on Congress and the bureaucracy, and kind of get his insight on being a not only inside player, but part of this bureaucracy. So let's take a look at that now. Okay, so before we take a look at that, you know, we're gonna set up a couple things, okay? You know, when we think about our government, we often have demands as citizens, right? And this is going back to some of the taxation, right? I think, while we get this video ready, I think it's important to kind of note that when the city, well, not only the city state, but the nation state started to rise, you know, democracy kind of followed in step, right? But the reason that, you know, democracy is somewhat prevalent is because of taxation, right? Because we kind of give up not only wealth, but power, we expect something back from the government. So the bureaucracy kind of plays a role in that, right? As we go through it, we'll see how, you know, the bureaucracy is expected to treat everyone equally. But, you know, what we're talking about is our ideals, right? So when we look at government, you know, one of the things we might point out is that not everyone has the same voice. So let's take a little, let's watch this video now, and then we'll be right back.
Well, I don't think it's any more difficult than it ever was to get things done. I think that's part of the deliberate design of the 45 men who wrote the Constitution. Remember, their central objective was independence from Britain, self-governance, and the prevention of any established or king-like authority in the United States. They had lived under a British king. They did not ever want there to be an American king. If you look back over history, they've been brilliantly successful. We've had 43 presidents and no kings in American life. And they wanted to disperse authority. They were very suspicious of the accumulation of authority in any one person. We know all the phrases, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts, absolutely. I think that first came from an Englishman, but nonetheless it was widely believed by the men who wrote the Constitution. And so they devised a complex system to disperse power, to make it hard to get things done. In fact, I believe that the Senate is a microcosm of all of the American political process, because in the Senate it is very hard to get anything done. It's much easier to block things, and I think it's an exaggeration, but captures the spirit of what the founders wanted to do by saying that in order to prevent bad things from happening, they made it difficult for anything to happen. And so getting a bill passed in Congress is not an easy job, particularly if it's controversial, covers a subject that affects large numbers of Americans, and probably rightly so. I was a Senate Majority Leader for 6 years, and I was enormously frustrated on many occasions by the rules and procedures of the Senate and by the difficulty of getting things done. But with the perspective that comes with time and not being directly involved in the job, the way I look at it is that if you go back over American history, in the most important tasks, maintaining sovereignty in the people, the preservation of individual liberty, equal justice applied equally to every citizen, opportunity for every citizen, we've done pretty well. Now, there have been ups and downs, there have been mistakes, there have been steps backwards, steps forwards, steps to the side. But on balance, I think you could argue that Americans are freer than they've ever been, more prosperous than they've ever been, better educated than they've ever been, healthier than they've ever been. There are some very early warning signals, very dangerous, particularly with respect to health and education, that are now appear. But on the whole, I think the system has worked, although it's very frustrating. And for those who like to get things done, it's particularly difficult. Well, there's no secret. It's not something that's outside of normal life experience. If you want to get support for anything, you seek to persuade. You obviously try to begin with a good idea. Before I went into the Senate, I was a trial lawyer. I tried many cases, and I had a very good rate of success, and people say, what's the secret? I say, well, begin with a good case. That's the best way to have success. If you get merit on your side, not always, but more often than not, you'll prevail. And I think the same thing is true in the Congress. I don't remember who said it. I heard Lyndon Johnson say it in a speech once, and I don't know who he was quoting, but he said something like the following. I can't remember the exact words. He said, it's not hard to do what's right. The really hard thing is to know what's right. And when you're in the Congress, this is a very big country. There are widely diverse points of view. There are 535 members of Congress, each of whom thinks that he or she is doing what's right by the country, by one's constituents, so forth and so on. So it reflects the country, and it requires, I think, first beginning with doing something good and right, certainly as you believe it, and persuading others that it is good and right for their constituents and for the country, and then working hard at it. I did a lot. I passed a lot of bills, and I can tell you it's very hard work.
Okay, so welcome back. So a little insight from a former senator on the frustrations, the hard work of trying to get something done within an organized system, something that has a hierarchy, something that's a bureaucracy. So we have a question for you all watching. And again, everyone who's watching, anyone who would like to participate, please do. We'd like nothing better. But we do have a question. What was your most frustrating experience you had with a bureaucracy? How did you handle the obstacles put in your way? Now, this is something that we all can relate to. For those of you taking the class, you've worked through an educational system that was defined by the bureaucracy. As a matter of fact, one of the purposes of the educational system is to kind of teach you how to deal within a bureaucracy with the different problems, how to follow the policies and follow the orders and the authorities and how to respect it, right? So that's one way to, think about it. So anyway, we do have one comment that came in. Hakeem writes in, I think there are positive and negative points to how the bureaucracy works. Of course, we need guidelines to protect us from abuse, but most of today's bureaucracies, I feel, are only there to complicate the issue and maybe shouldn't be so individualized, right? Okay, and this is one of the issues, and thank you for writing in, Hakeem. One of the issues that we will deal with as we go through this course, right? Whether or not the policies that are created and everyone is forced to go through with are actually as sound or as rational as we would like them to be, right? Oftentimes we find that some policies, because they're so hard to change, do not keep up with the pace of technological change, the shifts in the economy, or the needs that everyday work encounters. As a matter of fact, if you want to kind of comment on this too, one of the frustrations that you may feel might be rooted in the way your current or, a former job experience might have dealt you, right? Something that it presented you. Like, how did you deal with the actual policy? or the folks that, you know, work with in that environment actually deal with the policy in real life. You know, for example, was there a policy like, okay, you need to fill out this form in triplicate, but everyone kind of knew that it was already backed up in, you know, in a digital hard drive, so maybe that step was skipped, or, what kind of policies did you kind of bend or flex or maybe break in order to better help someone, right? So, you know, these are all things that, you know, we talk about the ideal, but in reality, what we're faced with isn't as clear cut. It's not like a cookie cutter, right? Everything fits in there and comes out the same. You know, life is very different and we all have to adapt to it, and work adapts to it, right? You know, what is written policy may not be what is, you know, practiced in reality. Or, you know, maybe if you're, you know, a manager or something, you know, the other frustration might be that your employees don't follow the policy and, you know, practice something very different. So anyhow, again, feel free to write in, call in, whichever you like, and we'll keep talking about the history till we get some comments in. So, during the rise of the bureaucratic organization, one entity or institution that we see the bureaucracies begin to emerge and is historically prominent in our history is within religious institutions. For example, you know, you can take a look at Christianity. The early successes of the church is in part attributed to adapting to the Roman organizational principles, right? The hierarchy, that's still evident today, right? You know, it goes all the way, you know, up to the Pope, but, every region has an archbishop, and then, you know, every church has, you know, a different division of priests, etc. You know, even within the rituals that are performed, there's different hierarchies. You can also kind of think about the looser structures found in Hinduism, Buddhism, and Islam. And in the modern era, you know, one of the struggles religion faces is maintaining the balance between spontaneous spirituality and the routinization and formalization brought on by the bureaucratic administration, right? You know, these rules and, you know, guidelines that everyone is supposed to follow, you know, kind of run into what people need and want. To think back to the economy, as the economy grew in complexity, it also fostered the growth of the bureaucracy. It began to spread from the political religious realms to private enterprises, right? Oftentimes, you know, one of the things that we have to think about when we see organizational structures or how we do things in everyday life is that when things are successful, others will copy it and adapt it to what they need, right? Later in this program, we'll discuss McDonaldization. It's one of the discussion topics for our course. But the reason people look at McDonald's or look at Starbucks or how Walmart, you know, operate, it's because they're so successful. And the reason they're successful, you know, is because of the way they're organized. And people copy, you know, this. So, you know, perhaps when we talk about McDonaldization, you might wonder, well, I don't see it at my bank. But if you look closely enough, you'll see the automation, the irrationality, irrationality. And, you know, we'll discuss this as we go. But whenever models are successful, you know, they're replicated in our society, you know. So as the economy grew, you know, first advancing technologies were creating new occupational specialties. This led it, into the specialization of labor. And because, you know, work began to become more complex, there had to be organization and coordination of these specialized activities. So these challenges had to be overcome. The scope of management widened for workers. As, you know, think back to when we talked about the factory. One of the things about the factory is that not only did it, you know, center, work in an area where it could take advantage of technological innovations that needed a centralized power source, but also, with a mass of people working, they also needed to be supervised. So within that, you start to see not only, again, the specialization of labor, but the need for a managerial hierarchy. And thirdly, you know, improved transportation increased the territory served by enterprises, and thus creating more administrative difficulties. One of the things that, for example, we take for granted nowadays, especially if you're in commerce or business, is the speed at which we can communicate. Now, when work was spread out, communication wasn't as fast, you know, this was a big hurdle, right? So perhaps, you know, managers were more, the importance of their ability to dictate and interpret policy was ever more so important than it is today, right? Because, you know, if you had a multinational company back in the 1700s, right, you know, communicating between the New York and London office was not a matter of seconds, but a matter of weeks. So, you know, that's something to kind of keep in mind. But, you know, that's kind of the same story with all technology, right? You know, as it advances, it creates faster, better work. Some jobs get displaced, but also, you know, new jobs are created, the division of labor grows. And the ideal is that, you know, all these different, technologies and new ways of working complement each other. But again, you know, what we're going to focus on today is that, you know, there's a need to complement. So let's talk about the elements of the bureaucracy, right? Now, Max Weber is whom we kind of accredit, you know, these definitions to, and he's really the one that kind of laid the ground floor and recognized how the bureaucracy works and what the ideal type is. And when we talk about the ideal type, you know, this is the ideal. It might not be, or it's very rare, or, you know, we never see it, an actual, you know, true bureaucracy at work, right? Because again, reality is different. So these are the ideal types. These are the characteristics that we see within bureaucracies. Now, not all bureaucracies will have all the ideal, not be defined by the, you know, the seven, you know, different ideals, but they'll all have elements of it, right? And they'll all be motivated by this ideal bureaucracy that is really, a mental idea, right? So anyway, again, you know, the ideal type is a mental construction, delineated essential features of a social phenomenon that may not fully correspond to the reality in the social world. So again, you know, bureaucracy is this, right? You know, what, and I mean, you might have, you know, a parallel in your own life or in your own work where the ideal doesn't, again, fit into the reality. But before we go on, you know, one of the first points we're going to talk about is this idea of rationalization and something that led to the iron cage, you know, which is something Max Weber is well known for. But to kind of set this up, we're going to watch a short video by Dan Ariely and his definition of rationality. Now, Dan Ariely is a behavioral economist, in the field of economics, rationality is everything. What motivates individuals to seek out the choices that they do? And when we talk about bureaucracies, you know, which are created by individuals, you know, we kind of have to think about what is the motivation of the bureaucracy? What's the goal, right? Because one of the things that we'll discuss is that bureaucracies are goal-oriented. Now, even though the goal might be irrational, the way we get to that goal is very rational. And we'll, you know, discuss that as we go. So anyway, Dan Ariely and his definition of rationality, and then we'll be right back.
I pick the standard economic definition of rationality because once you start incorporating all kinds of things into rationality, it just becomes a meaningless concept. So if you say, people are rational, but yes, but I also care about your welfare. And let's add that as another component of utility into the equation, that every time you're making up another part of utility, it means that you're kind of undermining the concept of rationality. And, you know, I'm a behavioral economist, which means that most of my work is showing that people are irrational, but I love economics. Economics is beautiful. It's a wonderful theory. It's a great perspective to have. I don't want to eliminate that. I think it has incredible amount of insights. However, what behavioral economics teaches us is that economics is not the whole story. It's not everything. And when you come to do policies or interventions or to give recommendations for people to how they want to live their life, you want to take as complete picture as you want, as you can. So you want to take the parts from economics that are accurate, and you want to fill as much as you can above that from how people actually behave.
Okay, so we're at rationality. Weber talked about the disenchantment of the world. One way to kind of think about this historical process is thinking about how people used to think about the world, right? For example, you're watching this on television, right? Maybe a few centuries ago, you might ask yourself, okay, well, you know, how would people explain what's going on, right? Because we, you know, base our rationality on science, on, you know, and efficiency and all that, you know, we kind of know, okay, well, there's something scientific going on in there. We might not be able to explain it, you know, like these are electrons, these are signals and whatnot, but we know that it's not magic, right? Someone maybe a couple centuries ago would say, oh, you know, Soto's living inside the box and he disappears, or I'm a ghost, or it's fairies, or it's something more spiritual or magical that is causing this to happen. So when we think about how to explain the world, right, you know, we structure it through science. And again, this is kind of bringing in some of that Taylorism that we discussed last week. And, you know, you can kind of connect the dots to that, right? Everything is, for the most part, you know, seeking out efficiency. And we'll talk about efficiency as we go, but, you know, that's how rationality works. So rationality is crucial for the design and operation of modern organizations, right? What's sought is the most effective and most efficient ways of attaining a particular goal, right? So when we organize, you can kind of think about this, right? Why do we organize? Is to achieve a goal, achieve some kind of work, right? Sometimes it could be very, you know, not so clear, right? If you think about, you know, the university, what's the goal? Well, it's to educate the population. Now, everyone within there, within a university is not seeking out the same education. Everyone has different goals, different aspirations within it. But ultimately, if we lump them all together, is to educate and provide the economy with a competent pool of labor that is able to do, you know, different types of work, whether, you know, it's in business with a business degree or in sociology with a sociology degree. So the way we structure it is the most effective, you know, ideally, the most effective and most efficient, right? Think about how, you know, you might, you know, kind of taking it to the micro kind of realm, how you might bake cake, right? We kind of talked about this before. We talked about how work is organized, you know, whether it's on a large scale or short scale, I mean, in a small kind of scale. So, you know, there's a rationality to it. You're going to, you know, ideally try to find the most efficient and effective way to bake that cake, right? And if we take it in a large scale with a bakery, right, you know, the most effective, efficient way of producing a large number of, you know, cakes, right? And when we talk about efficiency, it's not only time, it's wages, it's what's used, you know, the materials, all these different commodities, right? So at the same time, you know, rationally designed structures and processes can be used for goals that defy rational comprehension, right? So again, I kind of mentioned this before, right? You know, the way it's structured can be rational, but the goal may be irrational, right? One example that we've dealt with history is something like the Holocaust, right? You know, For the most part, the goal, of this unfortunate and, very horrific part of human history, the whole nation, a whole bureaucracy, several bureaucracies spawned out of this. But, one of the ways we know that, this happened is through the trail of paperwork. The bureaucracy left records and things, showing, train schedules, who was going where, to Auschwitz and all these horrific places. The Holocaust was a very bureaucratic endeavor. So although this was an irrational, barbaric thing, the functionality of it was very rational, right? Trains were scheduled to arrive at a certain time. People were, counted. People were trying to figure out what was the most, efficient and cost-effective way of doing all this, right? So, I mean, when we talk about, that's one extreme. But, I can use something more lighthearted and say, okay, well, if I'm building a ladder to the moon, right, rationally, that's not going to work, right? Science will say, oh, not going to work, not going to happen. But I can organize, the folks I need to help me build it using a bureaucratic structure. Now, we have a couple comments that came in, so we'll get right to them before we go into impersonality. Just to kind of wrap up this part of the rationality, Weber distinguished from formal and substantive rationality, substantive meaning to achieve goals consistent with society's ethical values, and formal meaning strict concern with quantitative calculation of accounting. And Weber also suggested that some societies' ethical values may not be in accordance with humane values. So the other thing we kind of have to think about in all bureaucracies is, okay, well, what are they really valuing? What's the rationale, right? Is it formal? Is it just the quickest way to get from point A to B, regardless of whose toes you step on, or is it substantive? So where we try to find the most, harmonious way to get to that point, even though it might not be the most efficient or effective, right? When we look at factories and how they're organized later on, we'll see how some factories, like in Fordism, it was all about calculation and efficiency, and it disregarded the worker and created a lot of alienation and an anomic environment. But today, we see some German factories or some factories that produce autos take a more they seek to create an environment that is a little bit more welcoming to the worker, a little bit more, or I should say actually a little bit less alienating. But the trade-off with that is that it actually takes longer, and it costs a little bit more to create a car, in the sense that you're not using labor as efficiently as you would like. So anyway, before we go into impersonality, we'll take a couple of comments. Sasha writes in, how do we form organizations to regulate and combat corruption and red tape from bureaucracies that tend to take advantage of taxpayers? An example, the banks and Federal Reserve are tied to three bailouts. Well, let me organize some thoughts for a second. This is a big question, right? Oftentimes, our solution to combating bureaucracies or corruption inside bureaucracies is with the creation of other bureaucracies, either, having another committee or, provide oversight, or creating another organization to help oversee or regulate that, agency or organization. So, one of the questions that you might be exploring, Sasha, is whether the bureaucracy is the right thing to deconstruct a bureaucracy. So, that's one of the questions that we've had. I guess, the quick answer would be to have more transparency, or to have transparency and review the policies that are, there. When we talk about policies and procedures, as part of the bureaucracy, they're open to question, because, that's the way the bureaucracy functions, right? That's the rule book. However, what happens is that, you know, oftentimes when we see corruption, it's not only folks who are, you know, directly stealing. Some folks, you know, it's often easier to manipulate the policies that are there, right? You know, when they're seen as obstacles, you know, there's a very, you know, if there's a, you know, if there's an, if there are obstacles to getting what you want or exercising power, people are very good at, you know, figuring out how to circumvent them. So, you know, again, there's no quick answer. As far as a bailout, you know, that's kind of tied more to economic theory. And a theory, you know, I'm, you know, just personally, I don't, well, I mean, I understand how the bailout or, you know, even now with the qualitative easing is supposed to work. But, you know, you kind of have to ask, okay, well, what are they trying to salvage or where is this money really going, right? Because, I'm going to kind of defer it a little bit. It's kind of more of an economic question, how the economy is structured, you know, if, you know, what part do you save is really the question. Because when it first started out, you know, there was a more emphasis on the folks at the bottom of the pyramid, if you will, you know, trying to kind of save or bail out people out of their personal foreclosures instead of just, you know, the debt. You know, the debt still exists for those at the bottom, but not on the ledgers of, you know, well, the debt shifted, I guess. Anyway, not an easy question, so you kind of got me on that one. But, you know, if you write me, you know, we can go into detail. We just don't have as much time here on this broadcast, unfortunately. But very good question, Sasha. So anyhow, we're going to go into the next portion, you know, the impersonality of the bureaucracy. Now, one thing about the impersonality, you have to think about not only how it influences you, how it affects you, but also those who are working within the system. So what we're going to look at next is a short clip from the film Office Space and a very famous scene. So we'll take a look at that now. We'll reflect on, you know, how the bureaucracy is interpreted in this film and how it reflects to our everyday life. So let's take a look at that now.
Hello, Peter. What's happening?
We have sort of a problem here.
Yeah, you apparently didn't put one of the new cover sheets on your TPS reports.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry about that. I forgot.
Yeah. You see, we're putting the cover sheets on all TPS reports now before they go out.
Did you see the memo about this?
Yeah. Yeah, I have the memo right here. I just forgot. But it's not shipping out till tomorrow, so there's no problem.
Yeah. If you could just go ahead and make sure you do that from now on, that would be great. And I'll go ahead and make sure you get another copy of that memo. Okay?
Yeah, no, I have the memo. I've got it. It's right.
Hello, Phil. What's happening?
Okay, so now we're connecting the rationality with impersonality and the hierarchical authority. So right there we see a situation where an employee is having to do something that's seemingly irrational, right? You know, although he understands that, you know, the TPS report has to have a cover letter or a cover sheet, nonetheless, the hierarchical authority, the manager in that situation, still wants him to get the memo, right? So, you know, if you have time to watch that film, it's kind of a good view of not only the bureaucracy, but, you know, a reflection on alienation and a number of other things. But anyway, let's talk about the impersonality of the bureaucracy as a characteristic. Now, impersonality within the bureaucracy contributes to the efficiency and effectiveness. You know, the idea here is that everyone is treated you know, equally under the policies. Now, again, this is within an ideal bureaucracy. So, you know, that's, you know, one of the things that we often feel, you know, it's not true about the bureaucracy. Some people are treated, you know, or have more advantages than others. But, you know, again, this impersonality contributes to effectiveness and the efficiency because everyone is treated the same within the policy. So there's no gray area, if you will. But most of us, again, have felt that we've been treated as a number or just a cog in the machine, right? What's important is not the worker. What's important is how policies and procedures are followed. So in that clip, what was important was the, you know, that everyone followed the rules regardless of, you know, who they were. But again, that's the ideal. In reality, you know, some of you might have instances or could share instances that, you know, a coworker, because they go golf with the, you know, manager or the boss on Sundays, is maybe giving more slack than other folks. Or that maybe you know someone within a bureaucratic organization and maybe you don't have to wait in line, right? But, you know, one of the things that, you know, again, going back to the DMV comment, you know, that we can all kind of find some solidarity in is that we all experience, you know, lines and things like that. We were all treated as a number within these organizations because we all are basically the same within the bureaucracy. So again, you know, there's some strengths and drawbacks to that. But again, you know, the question is, you know, does the bureaucracy really treat all people equally? You know, race shouldn't matter, but nonetheless, you still see institutional racism within banks, you know, just recently, and this is something we'll discuss later on, you know, with mortgages, it was found that Latino and Black loan applicants were given higher rates. And, you know, and this is something that a class action lawsuit was, you know, put forward in the courts, and the plaintiffs actually won, a settlement, or, you know, I don't know if it was settlement or were awarded a significant, you know, a large number. I don't know if it was in the billions, but it was definitely in the millions. They were awarded, Bank of America had to pay for it because they purchased, I think it was countrywide. Yeah, it was countrywide. But, you know, nonetheless, it was happening, right? Or within, so race and ethnicity shouldn't matter within the hierarchies, but they, you know, nonetheless, it does. Or gender, right? One thing we'll, you know, discuss is the glass ceiling, or, you know, sometimes the what's called the sticky floor, where, you know, women are stuck in positions or are unable to climb up, you know, the hierarchical ladder within businesses or enterprises, within, you know, these occupations, because, you know, although they meet all the requirements, although the bureaucracy says this person is eligible and policy and procedure says that they should be next or they should be promoted, they aren't because of, you know, a bureaucrat's prejudice, basically, you know, because nonetheless, people still have to interpret the information, interpret policy so people can bend it. So, you know, going back to this idea that was presented, you know, before by Sasha about the corruption within, you know, bureaucracies, you know, one way that we can, you know, push back, you know, is with the legal system and recognizing that this exists and being on the lookout for it, right? The other part of impersonality is also, you know, fundamental to staffing a bureaucracy. So ascribed characteristics should have no bearing. You know, these are what we're born as, or the color of our skin, or, you know, our gender. But, you know, people interpret them as kind of, you know, influencing our ability to do work. Again, that's how stereotypes work. You know, they impose, you know, moral character or different characteristics on to individuals without, you know, affording them an opportunity to prove themselves, right? And, you know, going back to the emergence of the bureaucracy, some folks were, you know, appointed into their position because of birthright, like within, you know, the meritocracies in China or the elites in Europe or all over the world, okay? Bureaucracies are also known for their complex division of labor. What we mean by that is who does what within the bureaucracy is defined by policies and procedures in this effort to find the most efficient and rational way of achieving a goal, right? So industrial societies like our own, we have a high number of specialized occupations. And organizations have hundreds of specialized jobs and titles within them, right? So such specialized jobs and associated tasks are incorporated into formal roles, and such roles define an employee's responsibility. And rules are established to govern the roles and not the person per se. So think about the jobs that we have in our society, right? One way to kind of think about it is when you go to the doctor, right? When you first go to the doctor, you might see a general practitioner, but before you even get to see the doctor might not do, you know, everything, you know, that's needed for a checkup. You have a nurse, maybe, or maybe a licensed vocational nurse, taking your blood pressure, checking your temperature, filling out part of the chart, right? That's separating parts of, you know, that labor. You know, if you kind of look at the goal or the task for that job as, you know, kind of giving you a physical, right? Think about who does what, right? You know, first, even before you show up at the doctor's office, you have to maybe contact the clinic or, you know, that office and think about, you know, think about it. The doctor's not the one who answers the phone, right? It's usually a receptionist, and receptionist, you know, sets up a time. You go in, they confirm it, you wait, you fill out, you know, a sheet or a form. You go in to see like a nurse or an assistant, you know, they do the initial kind of triage, and then the doctor comes in. Sometimes they confirm the blood pressure, they confirm, you know, different things. They ask you questions and they make a, you know, they evaluate you, right? If they find something that, you know, say needs some addressing, right? Say, you know, there's an issue with your heart or, for example, case like, you know, you need a follow-up on your heart. You know, generally it's not that doctor that takes care of that for you. It goes on to an expert, a cardiologist. So even within, you know, just that those few steps, we see how much the division or how pronounced the division of labor is. You know, even in the medical field, you know, you can go, you can think about how, you know, somewhere on the other side of the scale, you know, in the service industry, maybe in a restaurant, how that works, right? For instance, if you go to a fast food restaurant, you know, there's a cashier. The cashier has a number of duties, but it's not the same as a person who are, you know, people, folks who are cooking the food. You know, they're not the same folks necessarily taking the orders, you know, or filling up the drinks or cleaning the tables. You know, that's all kind of broken up. Now, that doesn't mean, you know, other folks can't take those jobs on, but the tasks are organized, right? For example, you know, if you're a secretary, you know, you aren't, you know, part of what's in your, you know, job title might be something like, okay, you're not supposed to, you know, take out the trash. That's not in your job description, right? So, you know, a job description, the duties that are associated with the task are all linked to the policies and procedures of a bureaucracy. So why did this all come about? Well, when we have a pronounced division of labor, it's a way of dividing up tasks among workers to develop specialized skills. And so work can take on a pace and develop, you know, and become, you know, more efficient and faster. The other part is, you know, kind of attributed to industrialization. As technology became more specialized, you know, you had a role, you know, you had the creation of positions where specialists could now undertake those tasks. You know, so the specialization is a critical process, and it creates a need for coordination. So time becomes very important, and also the rules and procedures and a hierarchical authority. Now, we have a couple of comments that come in. So Margie writes in, I see the bureaucracy in action at work. Operation employees make suggestions to improve processes. It is a slow change because the line manager reviews it, then it goes up the ladder before it is implemented, right? So there's a whole system there, right? Although, you know, the system constantly seeks to improve, it has to go through, you know, different, you know, stages, right? And, you know, just to kind of, you know, provide a kind of perspective on it, you know, oftentimes, you know, it's important to kind of take on those perspectives because, you know, everyone at different levels has a different perspective on what the need is of the operation. For example, you might see something that is, you know, clearly more efficient and effective for you, you know, but on the other side, you know, it might not be more efficient for the manager because maybe they're considering costs or maybe they're considering, you know, the number of hours you might have to work. Like you might say, oh, well, it would be more effective if I came in early before it opened, you know, before we opened and got this done. But, you know, a manager might say, well, that's not cost effective. That's another hour you have to work, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, that's something else that, you know, goes into the policy. So Cynthia writes in, it is theoretical that everyone is treated equally. However, in very large organizations, the competition between people at a given level to be viewed is viewed as the best is intense, you know, and she mentions perks, right? So, you know, one of the things that, you know, does arise in, you know, hierarchical structures where, you know, promotion exists is, you know, this motivation for competition. And in one sense, you know, one might want to foster that to motivate, you know, that, I guess that's one of the rationalities. But again, you know, one of the questions that, you know, pops into my head when, you know, with your comments, Cynthia, that although you can motivate folks with competition, you can also create a lot of disharmony, right? And our work sometimes has to be more harmonious, right? You know, you know, that's something that has to be taken with, I guess, a grain of salt, right? Because you don't want to create a workplace that is basically a battlefield between folks who are trying to self-promote, because then the goals shifts towards, you know, not accomplishing what the organization has set out to do, but each individual is, you know, striving to meet their own goals of self-investment. So, you know, they can undermine, you know, someone else's work and ultimately undermine the organization, although the other person might be ahead, the organization as a whole might fall back. So anyway, good point, Cynthia. Thank you for writing in. And again, you know, anyone watching can write in, call in with comments, suggestions, questions, observations. Again, we all, you know, work and exist within bureaucracies and deal with them all the time, so we all have something to say about it. But going back to this complex division of labor, again, you can think back to Durkheim and organic solidarity. You know, division of labor is something that creates some harmony in society, interdependence. And when we think about bureaucracies, you know, they're all, you know, they're very interdependent, right? If one person or one organization were a part of a company, right? Because it's not only the folks who do the labor, it's the different divisions within a company. Like, for instance, if you're part of a very large corporation, you have your legal department, you have your accounting department, you have your advertising department, managerial department, et cetera, and then you have the folks who are actually manufacturing. So right there, even the different departments are broken up into, you know, a very pronounced, divided, well, divided in the sense of who does what, you know, organization. All bureaucracies maintain a hierarchical authority structure, right? First, they serve to coordinate work. So the hierarchy, you know, someone in charge or a group of people in charge are there to coordinate work. But they also serve a number of other functions. They monitor workers' through the prospect of promotion. Again, you know, this was brought up by Cynthia. And they delineate responsibility, right? They organize workflow. They observe workflow. And they are, again, not only there to motivate, but to offer any disincentives for, you know, doing things out of what the expectation was, right? You know, managers, you know, if you think about one of the critiques that I often hear about managers is that they don't do anything, right? Well, the way work is divided, you know, they, you know, manager's role isn't really to do anything but to make sure that the work is being done to motivate individuals who are working under them and to see that the most efficient work that's ongoing is efficient and following the policies and procedures. Now they might do work to they might participate in the work to catch up, but again, you know, one of the things that, you know, if you're ever in a position that you're either managing folks or in a position where you have to manage or pick someone to manage folks, you know, how they build a team and how they, you know, kind of function with each other is very important. Because, I mean, again, you know, even though policy might, you know, again, this is the ideal between the ideal and the realistic. Ideally, this doesn't, you know, this often doesn't happen. You know, sometimes managers don't know how to coordinate work or what's the best way to motivate. You know, one way to really disenfranchise employees is to be overly harsh or discipline them in, you know, ways that are, you know, not constructive, right? So, you know, that's something to keep in mind within the bureaucracy and the actual work. Shauna writes in, there are many workplaces which appear to be close-knit companies instead of well-organized businesses. The qualities of management is what makes companies grow. Very true, Shauna, right? You know, actually, I'm trying to remember her name, but the new CEO of Yahoo, you know, kind of works out, you know, certain schedules with her employees. Don't remember who exactly her name, right? It's kind of escaping me. But one of the things that intrigued me was that how she has certain agreements with some of her staff on her teams. Like, for instance, you know, one thing she points out is that one way to kind of commit or have people kind of go the extra mile for the company is to kind of identify what's important to them, right? So in one case she shared or discussed was that she had an employee who saw her role as a mother and being there for a child's like soccer practice or something that's very important. So what she found is that in order to motivate her the best, because one of the things she said is that, you know, at a certain level, people will do the work no matter what, even if they have to stay late. So one of the important things is to recognize what's important to the employee and make sure those needs are met so they don't develop an angst or aggression towards the company. So for instance, this particular person, it was very important for her to pick up her daughter and take her to soccer practice and be there. So the rule was that once 4 o'clock came around, regardless if the meeting was important or not, whether it was she was integral or even there was a question immediately asked to her, once 4 o'clock came around, she was allowed to go, no questions asked. So, you know, that might work for some, that might not work for others, but, you know, it's something to kind of keep in mind, right? You know, the way people are motivated and regulated, right? Because, you know, it's not only carrot on the stick, but the whip too, you know, that we have to keep in mind. Now we have a call that we would like to take. Amit, hello, how are you?
I'm fine, how are you?
I'm doing well, thank you for calling in.
I perked up when you said that people often say managers don't do anything. Mm-hmm. And that's one reason I never went to MBA school is because I think MBA is a fluff degree, and I never really thought they'd teach anything. So I wanted your thoughts on whether people from within these various divisions of a company, you know, engineering, sales, whatnot, whether they make better managers versus whatever an MBA degree teaches people on how to do something abstract, which I've always been very, very skeptical about.
Okay, you know, there's I've read a couple articles, both kind of advocating one or the other. Personally, I think whenever whenever companies promote within the same field, like say, you know, one of the problems I think that you're kind of aiming towards is that, like, you have a team of engineers and then you put in someone with a business degree who has a different goal as opposed to the engineers. You know, like the engineer would want to make the best product possible, like say something that'll last 10 years and it might be a little bit more expensive, and therefore, you know, the best way to build it is this way. Someone with, you know, looking at the nickel and dime side would say, well, why don't we make it like this? Because it's, you know, let's not make this out of plastic. I mean, let's make this out of plastic and not metal. Where the engineer would say, okay, well, we can't really do that. You know, if it heats up, the plastic will melt eventually. And, you know, but on the other side, you know, a person might say, you know, the person looking at the dollars and cents will say, well, we're not here to make a product that will last forever. We're here to make something that'll sell. So that's kind of one of the hurdles that, you know, a lot of companies deal with. So in my opinion, you know, for me, but again, you know, I'm not looking at it from the dollars and cents part. You know, I would always defer to a person who's actually worked in the field, right? You know, you can always train someone to kind of take on that role as a manager, but it's often difficult, right? You know, you can't, you know, once, you know, one of the important things is to recognize that, you know, not everyone can lead, right? Someone might be a very good engineer, but be a terrible leader. You know, one way to kind of think about it is if you're into sports, right? Think about, you know, coaches, right? You have phenomenal players who end up in the Hall of Fame, but never cut it as coaches. And then you have folks who are like relatively nobodies. Like, I think like Jim Cowher really was not like a second string player. A few of them, you know, a couple different coaches were only like special teams and things like that. Yet, you know, these are the same coaches that lead teams to championships. So, I think at the end of the day, you really have to take individuals, you know, as individuals and recognize their strengths and their weaknesses. And not, sometimes those weaknesses will let you know you know, they can kind of shape them and use them to their advantage. So, you know, I don't have a clear-cut answer, but I guess that's my kind of insight on it.
Well, thanks for taking my call.
No, thank you for calling. It's a great question. You know, one thing you might want to look at is, you know, the different ways, you know, kind of Google structures their organizations. We'll take a look at that later as the class progresses. You know, one thing I always kind of pick through are, you know, different, you know, business sites, you know, sites like, you know, Money or Forge, or even, you know, my personal go-to one is called I think it's Business Insider, and they usually have good articles and things like that to, you know, kind of point out some things. So great call, great question. You know, again, you know, we're dealing with the ideal and the reality. You know, ideally, if you, you know, get someone with a certain degree, you know, they'll, you know, perform the job you want. But realistically, you know, how much of that is just a piece of paper, right? I mean, you can even question, you know, the education, you know, that we all, receive at one point, right? And, you know, one of the things that is being reconsidered in our world is, you know, what's referred to as the myth of education. Now, personally, you know, I think the best way to, you know, achieve class mobility within our society is through education. You know, opens up opportunities, but, you know, one of the questions that we have to ask is, you know, where does debt start to outweigh the benefits, right? Because, you know, if you go to a law school or, you know, or any kind of, any educational institution, right? You don't want to be basically a slave to debt, right? So, you know, there are some tough choices that are, you know, realities for everyone. But again, you know, something like a degree, sometimes you have to, you know, one of the big hurdles is also that you need that piece of paper in order to satisfy a policy. I mean, you can have a great business leader, you know, but unless they don't, you know, if they're, you know, if someone, you know, if a certain organization requires like an MBA, right, that person will never get a shot. But oftentimes, you know, in the business world, when, you know, you're able to produce results, that things like that can be overlooked. So anyhow, the final characteristic of the bureaucracy is the use of written records, right? Records are essential for preserving and implementing rules, regulations, and procedures. You know, this is what ties everything together. Started off with taxation when the emergence of the first states, right? Keeping track of who gave what, how much was given, and how to keep track, you know, to make sure not too many eggs, you know, disappeared on the, you know, way to market, if you will. But it also, you know, something to kind of think about is like how the census came about, right? You know, that's an active kind of data. It's data collection, but it serves to kind of figure out how much resources a population needs, but how much taxation, you know, can be, how much tax revenue can be expected. So, you know, a couple different things to kind of think about as we go through this. So let's talk about where the bureaucracy doesn't work, and or where it works and where it doesn't. And we've kind of been exploring this as we, you know, go through this section. So not all work environments or occupations are best suited for bureaucratic organization, right? Sometimes they get in the way, and, you know, hopefully we'll have time. We'll go explore some different models like cooperatives or matrix organizations where the hierarchy can come into question. But overall, the bureaucracy does have some real strengths, right? First and foremost, it's something everyone is, you know, familiar with. When most, if not all, tasks are performed are routine, the bureaucracy is extremely effective, an extremely effective organizational form, right? So, you know, the more it gets routinized and all that good stuff, you know, the stronger and more efficient it becomes. However, with routine, there are some shortfalls that we're going to get into. The situations and challenges, you know, that aren't routine, right, are what really slows people down, right? So that's when you start to see the emergence of the bureaucracy as problematic. You know, personally, when I think back of all the obstacles I may have had to face with the bureaucracy is when I have a situation that someone might not be able to answer, or that they have to kind of get out the rule book to really figure out what's going on. Right? That's when it's really inefficient, right? If it's just everyday transactions, things that people see every day, it's a piece of cake, right? You know, that's what people are used to. But, you know, again, something like that, or something that falls outside of policy when things are new situations, or like we kind of discussed before, when it doesn't keep in pace with changes in society, changes in technology, that's when it becomes problematic, right? So, you know, something that you might have, wondered or have an issue with, especially if you're hiring or trying to get hired, is that sometimes the requirements, you know, might be too low, and you get individuals who don't have the technological know-how that's necessary. Or, you know, if you're pursuing an education, you have to perhaps study something that's redundant. You know, I'm thinking something like within technology, like maybe a computer programming, you know, language that is going to be, you know, it's basically on its way out within society, but nonetheless, you still have to learn it. So, you know, there are some problems with that. So some things that are poorly suited to bureaucratic organization. You know, engineering was brought up earlier, right? Scientists engage in cutting edge research. You know, the bureaucracy gets in their way, right? How can you have creativity if you constantly have to answer to an authority figure to give you the okay? Or, you know, one thing that stifles creativity or scientific research today is the bureaucratic side of money, right? You know, making sure things are under budget and things like that. So, you know, because research is an unpredictable process, you know, routines, you know, aren't something that's good, right? You actually want to, you know, fall out of that. So then this, to necessitate creativity, you know, something like within research or bureaucracy is not a good thing. Because again, one of the critiques of the bureaucracy is that you're not supposed to think. You're not supposed to be creative. You're supposed to follow the rules that someone else has, you know, outlined for you, right? Now they get to be creative because they're the ones that, you know, produce the policy, but not you. You know, you're a cog in the machine, again, going back to that impersonal part of it. One of the things that, you know, we're starting to question in our society and there's a debate over is, you know, the education of children, right? You know, on one hand, you know, public schools, you know, teach children a great deal. There's a fair amount of learning that has been and continues to be routinized, and school administrations tend to be very large because, you know, the amount of coordinating is very large. And, you know, there's a certain set of, you know, dictated knowledge that has to be taught to these children. But again, you know, the formal rules, you know, kind of stifle creativity. One of the issues that we have in our society right now is whether standardized testing is the way to go, right? You know, whether, you know, educators are stuck teaching to a test and, you know, children on the other side aren't encouraged to be creative, right? They're encouraged to regurgitate facts and not explore areas of knowledge that will not be on the test, right? You know, it really restricts how resources and learning happens, right? So, you know, something like, you know, standardized tests forces school to become routine and a very bureaucratic process where, again, you know, if you think about how, you know, education is structured, there are boards, panels, groups of individuals who decide what should be taught and when it should be taught. And then teachers have to interpret this. And on top of that, you know, there are test guidelines, like standardized tests with, you know, especially with something like No Child Left Behind that will affect the school's funding. So the motivation is there to get these children to pass, which if they do pass and get a high school diploma is great. But the other question we have is, okay, well, what kind of education did they receive, right? Now, if it's a society where we just want folks to fill bureaucratic positions, it's very good, right? You know, you have a whole generation of children who go in to school, learn how to follow policy, learn how to follow directions, do not, you know, wander away too much from, you know, what's expected of them or how to interpret a set piece of knowledge. So, you know, lack of creativity within the bureaucracy, if you're just following rules and, you know, counting beans and pushing paper is very good. But on the other side, you know, if we're gonna have scientists for tomorrow or great thinkers or artists, you know, something like the bureaucracy does not encourage that. So before we move on to how the bureaucracy affects work and the workers, we'll take a small break and we'll watch, a short animated cartoon featuring Dilbert and management coordination, and then we'll be right back.
Make sure you coordinate with the brand manager and the category manager, and also the clients, the account execs, the project leaders, strategic planning, facilities management, product managers, marketing, and IT.
All I heard was give up.
Let's meet again in a year.
That's my plan. I'd like to thank all of you for your utter apathy. A few of you stayed awake, and I think I got some accidental eye contact once when the AC made a noise. In conclusion, I hate my job. I hate my coworkers. And I hope feral cats eat every one of you.
Are you taking questions?
Okay, so bureaucratic organization, work, and the workers. Now, some of you might be familiar with Dilbert, some of you might not, but you know, he's the epitome of the worker, far more creative than his environment, but restricted by the policies, procedures, and the hierarchy or you know, that he's trapped within. So, you know, something like that, you know, screams kind of a abject reaction to the bureaucracy, and is very critical of it. So, you know, definitely something, you know, if you have time, definitely check out. But anyhow, regarding work, right? So like we discussed, you know, routine tasks are very good for the, you know, for bureaucratic organizations. They're powerful tools for mobilizing large groups of folks, but they do tend to alienate workers. You know, in this clip, we saw that, the hierarchy, the, you know, routinization of everything really disenfranchises workers and kind of disconnects them from time to time. And one of the struggles within work organization or organizational psychology is how to keep employees motivated, right? So what we're kind of look at is why work in some cases motivates people and why it doesn't. Why the organization itself, although, you know, efficient and, you know, a bureaucracy might achieve its goals, at times has a very adverse effect for those who are working within it. So, you know, the key issue in this is how power is distributed in the bureaucracy and the consequences it has for workers, right? So one of the things that, you know, we can go back to some of the, you know, some of the Marx we were learning is this idea of alienation, right? One of the things that really connects us to our spiritual human side is our ability to create. However, within the bureaucracy, a lot of that, if not all of it, depending on the role you play, is kind of siphoned away or non-existent, right? Because the rules and policies are already written, because the division of labor has been specialized and maybe specialized to a point where it's been simplified and de-skilled, you know, your role is very plain. It's very simple. It's very, pre-coordinated, and there's no room for creativity, right? So, I mean, that's why a lot of folks get frustrated. And I mean, it's also important to kind of point out that, you know, people experience this at different levels, and, you know, with when folks further their education, they have more control over what they do. You know, the example we've used before is if you work at a factory using, a die cast press or something that stamps, you know, out metal cutouts with a machine, right? Your job is the same all day, right? You might be an expert with the machine, but it doesn't change. You know, you don't get to decide how the machine operates, how you cut out, the shape in the piece of metal. You don't get to do any of that. You just make sure the machine works or press a button or pull a lever, as opposed to someone who has a lot more, you know, a lot of specialization, maybe, like a doctor. A doctor will make their rounds and, use their knowledge and creativity to diagnose folks. So there's a little bit more of a sense of, joy or control associated with the work they do, and, you know, they might feel less alienation. You know, somewhere we can kind of see, you know, the spectrum is, you know, with Apple. You know, just earlier this week, there was a few workers, something like 2,000 workers or something like that, rioted in one of the factories that Apple has a contract with. Now, Apple doesn't own them. The company's called Foxconn. It's a Taiwanese company. Oh, it's Taiwanese-based, but their companies are in China. A lot of the workers had a riot, you know, in this one factory, workers incited a riot, you know, in reaction to the way they were treated and instance of brutality perpetrated by one of the security guards hired by that company. So at one level, you know, those folks who are putting together, you know, different gadgets, you know, I bring, you know, Apple into it because everyone knows it, but you know, they make all kinds of stuff like PlayStations, et cetera, TVs, you know, they have contracts with everyone. So, you know, somewhere like Apple doesn't own their factory. They just have a lease with, or an agreement with Foxconn to create it. But anyhow, on one level, you know, a person who makes, you know, an iPhone bit by bit, part by part, by putting one piece together over an assembly line is very much alienated. But on the other end, you know, someone who actually designs the iPhone, maybe they get to be in that video when they premiere it, right? Talking about how they have polished aluminum and rounded edges and the creativity that went into it. You know, they're not so alienated and they're compensated quite well for it too, right? So some, you know, if we asked the same two folks, like whether you feel alienated or maybe something everyone can relate to, do you hate your job or do you dislike your job? You know, the person in the assembly line might be more inclined to say they dislike their job, as opposed to someone in the creative part might be more inclined as saying they really enjoy their job or it's their passion, right? Right, so. Cynthia writes in, a huge example of record keeping is the ISO 9000 requirements. Now, I'm not familiar with what ISO 9000 is, unfortunately. If you want to write back, or maybe someone with our staff knows, you know, they could, you know, let us in on the secret. It would be interesting to, you know, I like to learn too. So that's why I like whenever you all call in or comment in. So Margie writes in, do you think the players on Big Brother and Survivor shows create their own bureaucracy in an attempt to win? You know, I'm not too familiar with the shows, but I know there's a hierarchy, there's groups, how work is divided becomes an issue. You know, there's a need for everyone to kind of do their share. Now, if you can find an instance where, or share an instance, since I'm assuming you're probably more familiar with those shows than I am, where, different tasks are, you know, afforded different folks, then definitely that would be, a sense of the bureaucracy. Now, where the bureaucracy does exist for those shows are on the production side, right? You have a director, you have, people working on the scripts, people working on the cameras, people holding lights, and that's all coordinated. There's people doing specialized work. Like a sound person might not necessarily, work on the lights or vice versa, you know, and definitely anyone working on the production might not, on the actual show production, like filming, recording sound, will definitely not, you know, take care of like the craft services where food is made. So, I mean, we're, the food for everyone is, going to be made, provided, and, taken care of. So, you know, there's different parts to that. We do have a couple of other questions, but we'll get to them in a second. So formal rationality applied to many bureaucratic structures and procedures itself is problematic. This is something Weber kind of pointed out. You know, again, we talked about Marx, the division of labor and the hierarchy of organizational devices to control workers and accumulate profits. You know, affect the worker more poorly than will affect the worker far worse than it will the how should I say, the bourgeoisie, or the person buying the labor. Now, we do have a answer for the iOS 9000. The iOS 9000 is a family of standards which are related to the quality management systems and designed to help organizations ensure that they meet the needs of customers and other stakeholders while meeting statutory and regulatory requirements related to a product. Whew. The bureaucracy at work, you know. And then, you know, talking about products, if you ever like look at something you buy, you can see different stamps, different, you know, codes on it. You know, if like what's your phone, you'll see FCC, you know, whether it was approved or when it was approved by the FCC. The patents, you know, we have offices that deal with patents and protect trademarks and ideas. You know, et cetera. You know, there's, you know, a number of things, and, you know, you can explore those things in the everyday. And, you know, the bureaucracy touches everything you produce and consume, and then you consume, right, for the most part. Robert writes in, there is something called the Harvard syndrome, namely that one can manage something they know nothing about. There is a danger in that. Not everything is about touchy-feely leadership in the real world. We have far too many that are functionally illiterate, that are graduating based on time in the classroom rather than essential knowledge. You know, and that's one of the, thank you for writing in, but yeah, that's one of the big issues that we have in our society, right? You know, and we have to think about, you know, part of that is linked to what our economy needs, right? One thing that we'll explore later on is, you know, how important a degree is. Right. To a certain extent, you know, it does have a function of limiting who has access to certain jobs, the same way licensing and things like that do. Right. You know, one of the big worries is that high school isn't enough anymore for the average person. You know, it is a necessary requirement for a lot of jobs. But as work becomes de-skilled, you know, when we talk about de-skilled, you know, anything that, you know, requires, you know, critical thinking, you know, is kind of redesigned in order to take that process out. Because whenever someone has to think critically, you know, it kind of spends up time, and, you know, within the production, you know, within the assembly line, you know, it's all about speed. So to a certain extent, you know, one of the problems is that we have an illiterate population, but, you know, just to kind of think more cynically, I mean, to a certain extent, and you know, there are folks who kind of theorize like this, like how much of the population really needs to be educated, right? Now, I'm not one of those folks who prescribes to this because, you know, it sounds, well, to me, you know, it's very, you know, unfair and it's not necessarily, it's not the society I'd like to live in. But anyway, there's some folks who will argue that, okay, well, you can have illiterate folks, you need them, you know, to fill out these positions. Like if you're familiar with how, you know, something like the fast food industry works, you know, you can have pictures, right? And you know, that'll, you know, get enough done, you know, and, you know, this is a real question too. I mean, that confronts the, you know, educational system. It's like, okay, we would like a society full of scientists and scholars and intellectuals, but how many do we actually need to keep the economy going? You know, that's a, you know, I mean, I think they've, you know, rationalized it too much, but I mean, it does make a population passive and controllable if you do, you know, if you don't educate them, right? And to a certain extent, you know, if you only have like 10% of the population creating, you know, the new economy, that's a pretty good number, right? You know, you can think about it today, like how, you know, what percentage of the economy, what percentage of graduates actually go on to, you know, revolutionize the economy? A very small amount. Everyone else is kind of, and including myself, right? You know, it's kind of like part of the bureaucracy, part of the middle management, part of what keeps just the system going. You know, we don't really change all that much, but we keep everything kind of functioning. So You know, again, it's one of those questions that we're kind of still trying to figure out. We don't have an answer for it. And, you know, I guess that's one of the scary things. There is a, you know, one of the critiques of the bureaucratic personality that Merton brings up is the bureaucratic virtuoso, right? This is a functionary who closely adheres to all the rules and procedures, but rarely accomplishes anything of significance. So, you know, this is something that maybe, you know, you've had the pleasure to work with a bureaucratic virtuoso, right? So although it sounds like, you know, a compliment, in actuality, this person, a bureaucratic virtuoso, is trapped within the bureaucratic ritualism of the everyday. So policies and procedures, come before everything, right? You know, it's all about the policies, it's all about the procedures. And, you know, this is a dysfunction of it, of the bureaucracy, right? You know, a lot of work stagnates, a lot of progress ends because of some of these bureaucratic virtuosos. So, you know, you can maybe, you know, have some fun and call someone you know a bureaucratic virtuoso. Now, some things that we didn't have time to really get into, but definitely kind of explore on your own or definitely online in your text, is something like the McDonaldization of society. We mentioned it before. We'll have some, you know, I'll include it in a later broadcast for everyone. But that's something that's shaping the world now. Some of these tenets that were brought about by the McDonald's organization, you know, have been copied by different industries, banking, commerce, you know, financialization, things like that. The automation of the world, a lot of it was first recognized with McDonald's, right? Like an example, right? You can think about how driving through a fast food restaurant drive-through is similar, or how it's been adapted to the banking world. And last but not least, you know, the bureaucracy is just kind of the de facto. They're all alternative, alternatives like horizontal kind of organizations and communal or cooperative. So that's it for today. Unfortunately, we ran out of time, but we'll try to get some of this later on. And until then, bye-bye.